Hi everyone. So this is developing interface builder plugins. My name's Jon Manning, and I'm from the University of Tasmania, and I'm also a developer at a Tasmanian-based game developer called Secret Lab. So you've made some custom controls in the past, I'm assuming. You've done some subclassing of NSView, and you've made your own controls, and you know how to make your own things interact with Windows. But you wouldn't be able to customize these controls and these new subclasses of NSView at design time. Because right now, all you can do is modify the properties and the parameters in your code. And you've seen Interface Builder, and you've seen the fantastic library of components, and you want to be able to drag and drop your stuff just as easily as Apple stuff can. Well, I'm here to show you how to do that. So we have here the library, and this is the main focus of Interface Builder, apart from your Windows, of course. Yes? Oh, dear. Oh, we have no picture. There we are. There we are. Okay. I'm sorry. I didn't... Any other slides not visible? Never mind. Okay. So we've had... We've seen the library that contains all of the objects you can drag and drop. Let's add some stuff into the library. I'll show you how to do that today. The way that you add stuff into the library is through the creation of what we call IB plugins. So these are just plain bundles. The Interface Builder knows how to load and insert into itself. These are just code that you write that's loaded into Interface Builder. You provide your own views that are displayed in the library and also in your designed windows. These are really good for reuse, as you might imagine. So if you've written a custom control and you want to be able to deploy it to somewhere else, then all you have to do is put it into a IB plugin and ship that out. Now, a couple of things that this talk is not about. I'm not going to tell you how to do custom controls in Cocoa. I'm not going to tell you how to do handling of events or mouse input. And I'm not going to tell you about the theory behind outlets and actions in Cocoa. I kind of assume that you know all that already. If you do have any questions, however, please raise your hands. Please feel free to interrupt me at any point. But please be aware that I'm focusing mostly on how to create your own custom controls. Sorry, how to create, how to put your custom controls, rather, into Interface Builder. So with that in mind, let's dive in. When you're making an Interface Builder plugin, the first thing that you do is set up the your basic project. Xcode comes with a template. And this is what you start with when you say, new project, give me one. Okay, so a few things that we can see in the sources here. You're really making two things when you're making Interface Builder plugin. You're making the plugin itself, and this is responsible for telling Interface Builder about your controls and your code and how it looks and how you're meant to present it and other stuff like the text and the description and labels. But there's also the framework where the actual control lives. So it's really separated out, the idea behind your code and the stuff that IB cares about. Okay, so let's take a look in a bit more detail at the anatomy of a plugin. So, in the left-hand side here, we have our files involved in our project. The first one on the top of the list here is the class description file. This is used by Interface Builder to take a look at it tells Interface Builder about the actions and the outlets of your class and of your custom controls. IB will actually look inside your bundle looking for class description files, and for every single one that it finds, it realizes, oh yes, I know about this file, I can put it in the library. These classes here, so sample.h and sample.inspector.h, the first one is kind of misleading. Sample.h and sample.m are the plugin files. So this is a subclass of IB plugin that provides information to Interface Builder about things like the locations and names of important nib files and other things necessary for the running of the plugin. The inspector is a subclass of IB inspector, and that provides a method for running the code behind the inspector palette, which we'll talk about more in a second. Sample view integration, this is actually a category on the class you see down below, sample view. And this is extra methods that are added to the class when Interface Builder is interested in them. So this is stuff like the location of the image that's displayed document view, and other small stuff. Now this is only compiled for Interface Builder, so only Interface Builder knows about this. Next up, we have two nib files here. We've got the library and the inspector. The library describes what it looks like in the library, and the inspector is a view that is that appears in the inspector palette. So we'll take a bit more detailed look at this in a bit. Finally, we have your code itself, the bit that you've written, the bit that you want to be pushing out to people. And this can be whatever you like. This can be an NS object subclass, this can be an NS view subclass, it can be anything you like. Anything that you want to bundle up, put in the library, and make reusable. Okay, so that's the anatomy of the plugin. So what do you need? So just go over this one more time. What do you need? You need the object itself, so the code that you've written. You need class description, so that IB knows how to represent it in the library. You need a library nib, so that IB knows how to draw what appears in the library. You need the inspector nib, so that IB knows how to draw and what to hook up to in the inspector palette. And finally, you need integration methods, so that IB knows how to deal with your object. Okay, so that's quite a bit. So the important thing to look at right now is the fact that we have a library nib and the inspector nib. Okay, so I've written a sample NSView subclass that is basically a rounded rectangle that is configurable. So we can set a border, we can set its roundedness, we can set colors for the line and the fill. Okay, so let's get started. Okay, so I start by firing Xcode. Now, when I create and use Interface Builder plugin project, I'm going to call it DevWorldKit because that's the name of the framework that I'll be shipping out to all my customers. Okay, so as you saw before, there's all of the files as I mentioned. Okay, so it's. No, that comes with Xcode. Yeah. Okay, is it not appearing in your list? Okay. You'll find it in application plugin. Yeah. Okay. So it's assumed that I want to create a subclass of NSView, and it's set up a framework for me here, and that contains this object here, DevWorldKitView, which is a very simple subclass of NSView. So I've written some code already that's going to do the drawing of this view. So if I jump back into my little bin of code here. Okay. So this is our implementation. And the header. So very simple. If you want more information on customizing your views and customizing subclasses of NSView, then I strongly recommend the Developer Connect site, developer.apple.com. If you don't know about that already, it's fantastic. Okay, so we've just now subclassed NSView. I'm just going to take you through a few components of this code. So that the view contains a color representing fill and stroke. It contains floats representing width and roundedness. And we've also got a delegate, which we don't use too much in this talk, but it's important to show you how outlets work later on. The code itself is quite straightforward. We have, at the very base, draw rect, which simply draws a rounded rectangle with the parameters that we've set. Okay. So the focus here is on Interface Builder plugins, not the code itself, but I just want to make sure that you're familiar with what it's going to do. Okay. So we've subclassed NSView. We've got our own view here. Now it's time to represent what this is going to look like in the library. So if we open up the library nib file, Xcode has prepared for us. Whoa, okay, I'm going to quit IB first and start fresh. Okay, so when we open up the library, okay, this is what we start with. So it set up for me a sample of library objects. So this object here, well, it looks like a simple container, is in fact quite special. This is an IB library template view. Everything contained within this view is what is represented in this part of the library. So in the case that you want to have a non-view object, you simply drop an image view into there, and that's what Interface Builder uses to represent it, which we'll get into in more detail later on. So I'll start by just removing these. Okay, don't need them. I'm only going to have my special view. Now, it started by assuming that I want a plain empty NS view. That's not the case. I want to change the type of it, so I go to the identity pane in the inspector and change it to DevWorld Kit View. It auto-completes it for me, and there we are. So while it looked like not much, I have just set up what it was going to look like in the library. Okay. And now, the way that we test this is simply build and run. What Xcode will do is it will compile first the framework that contains my object, then it will compile the plugin, and then it will launch Interface Builder, or another copy of Interface Builder, with my plugin loaded. So this is a way to test your object and test your framework and your plugin at the same time. Okay, so when I hit build and run, oh, hello. Okay. Ah, that would be why, because I haven't included the properties. Okay. Okay. Now we run it. Okay. So we've got in our library DevWorld Kit View, which is displaying as its default, so a slightly rounded blue bordered red rectangle. Now, it's got no name, it's got no label, it's got no description. We can fix this. But first of all, I just want to show you the fact that it's working. So I've just made a new window, and I can simply drag and drop. Okay, so that was my subclass of InnerView, and now I can drag and drop between windows. I can drag it over into here. I can even drag it between documents in Interface Builder. So this is practically done, apart from the fact that it's kind of ugly and doesn't do everything that I want it to yet. So that really demonstrates exactly how easy it is to do this stuff in Interface Builder. Okay, so when I quit Interface Builder, you notice down here, I actually have two copies running. This one here is the one run and launched by Xcode, and that's actually being debugged by Xcode. So I can actually step into my plugin's code and debug it. Because keep in mind, any code that I write inside the control is being executed by IB. So I can crash it if I wanted to, and I have in the past. This one here is the real IB, and this is the one that I'm using to create the views represented in my library. Okay, so when I quit this, no, I don't want to save this. Okay, so the next step that we're going to do, and I think I'll just jump back into my slides. Important things to keep in mind when you're doing your controls is that you need to conform to the NS coding protocol. This is because the way that Interface Builder does all of the magic that it does, where you drag and drop views from any place to another place, is it actually encodes and archives every single property of your object into memory, and then uses that to drag it around. So if you have any settable attributes, and you will have settable attributes, you need to implement the encode with coder method and the init with coder method. And in that, you need to serialize and deserialize every single property in your object. If you don't do that, weird things happen. So this is kind of an explanation of all the magic stuff that IB does. It's just simple applied use of NS coding. Another thing to keep in mind is that if you are changing the any properties that reflect what the view looks like, you need to call self set needs display yes, because otherwise your view won't know to update. So for example, as we get into later, if we're going to be adding some controls that change the color of the view, if we don't say set needs display yes, then nothing will happen until too late. Okay, so we've added our view, we've added our control, but it doesn't do very much right now. We want to have it interact. We want it to be able to receive actions, just like your normal objects can. We also want to declare the fact that it has an outlet. So I'm going to do that now. So close that. Now, I mentioned before it doesn't actually have a label or a description. We can fix that right away by opening up the library and having a look at the template object. Now, the inspector for this contains a variety of parameters. We can set the label. So if I just bring these up side by side. Okay, so the label matches up with the text in bold here. The summary, which is an 8 to 12 word description of the object, so very, very short, and it fits within a box only that big, and it will be truncated if it's too long. And that's meant to quickly summarize the object. And description, that appears down here. And this can be longer. We recommend 2 to 3 sentences. It's nice. Other stuff here, you can change how the scaling happens. So as I drag objects in and out of IB, notice how it's changing slightly. I'll just zoom in a bit. So this panel here expands. Now, the way that this is doing it is it's actually scaling from the icon there into the view itself, but we can also have it go from that icon to another icon. We'll leave it as default right now. Finally, you can set whether this is a representative class template. And if you check that, then you will be unable to drag it into a view. So this is for non-view objects, if you only want to be able to drag into the nib rather than the window itself. Okay, and we're doing that later on. So I'm going to change some stuff here. I'm going to call it the awesome view. And the path here, which I didn't mention before, the path is used for organizing it. So we have this drop-down view here. We have, at the very base, the Cocoa plugin, but we have an application subcategory and then a menu sub-subcategory. So in this manner, we're able to create our own organization for this. So I'm just going to say, okay, paths begin with a forward slash at the start, and you can include as many paths as you like. So summary, a rounded rectangle control. Okay, so when I run this, save that, jump back to Xcode, and go build and run. And there we are, there's our information. We've got a label, we've got a summary, and we also have a description. Okay, so if we go back to our code, you'll see here that we have a couple of properties here. We've got colors, we've got width and roundedness, we've got a delegate, and we've also got an action down here. And this code here simply calls a method that that swaps out the fill color and the stroke color. So you send this message, and the line becomes red, the fill becomes blue, and it then does a repaint operation. I mentioned before, every single time you change a visible property, you must call setMeasDisplay. That means that you do need to override any setters. So as we see here, this is the method for swap colors. We simply swap out the colors and then call setMeasDisplay. Okay, so we want to be able to declare the fact that our object can respond to this message in Interface Builder. The way that we do that is we go back to the class description. Now, this is actually a ASCII format plist, and we can modify all of this. We're going to add an action here. We're going to say that it is swap colors. Now, we can declare that we can only accept this kind of message from objects of a certain class. So right now, we're accepting messages from ID, so any object. But we could declare that it only comes from NSViews or their subclass. With outlets, we declare the name of it and the type of it. So the outlet is, in fact, an ID, and the name of it is delegate. We can also declare more information about the class itself, so the name of it and its superclass, but we don't care about that right now because it's correct. Okay, so we've just modified our class description, and IB now knows some more information about our object. So when we run it, okay, launches again. I'm going to create a new window. Okay. So here's our plain empty window. We drag it in, And now, one of the things I hadn't shown you yet before, the fact that we have a inspector already set up. This is a sample one that doesn't attach to any properties of the view yet, but we'll be getting in it shortly. We also have some outlets and actions. So this is the delegate property of our object, which we can hook up to anything we like. And there's also the swap colors action. So what we can do right now, and without writing any more code, we can hook up a button to that object and demonstrate it. Okay, so I'm going to drag in a button from the library, drop it, give it a label, swap, and holding down the control key, actually I'll do it another way, so the button sends an action, we drag and drop onto the view, and we hook it up to the swap colors method. Now what we can do is run this from Interface Builder's simulator. So I go simulate interface from the file menu. So now we see that our code is responding to methods sent by the button, and we wrote no further code to do that. So if you were to package this up and send it out to your users, from their point of view, it would just be code-free magic. Simply by dragging and dropping and connecting up these things, they would have free functionality. And that's a really powerful thing for a developer to have, because they like getting things for free. You like getting things for free. It feels good. Okay, let's quit this. Okay. So, other things to keep in mind. Your plugin runs in Interface Builder's main thread. It doesn't spin off a new thread for your plugin. So, anything that you do inside your plugin takes up time that will, if it goes for too long, block the entire program. Don't run expensive operations in the plugin. You will crash or slow down Interface Builder and make it a horrible user experience for the developer. Interface Builder does not garbage collect. So you cannot require that your plugin do garbage collection. But your framework and applications that use your framework might have to run in garbage collection mode. So you need to run in GC supported mode. You need to be able to declare to Xcode that you run in a mode that is both memory managed, so the old style, so retain release, but also in garbage collection mode. This means you need to actually take both memory management styles into account. So you need to both maintain strong references and at the same time retain and release appropriately. Okay. Other stuff you may want to do, I mentioned before that there is a interface builder integration category that is declared on your object when you're working with the plugin. In this method, you can declare all kinds of operations like IB awaken designable document and IB did remove from designable document. They're called appropriately when you drag and drop the or remove or edit the or drag and drop or remove the objects from the library. So this is an opportunity for you to do one-time configuration of your object when they get added in. And these never get called by consumers of your class. Okay, for more polish, we can add some default icons and labels. So right now, if I dragged and dropped this this view anywhere else in the document, so say you make it a top-level object in the nib, it would just be a plain view icon. If we want to customize that and make it more of a professional-looking framework, then we can do a couple of things. We can set an image that appears in the document view, and we can also set a default label. So we're going to do that right now. Okay, so I have made this icon here, all right? And I'm going to use that as a representative for an icon later on, for a control. So I just drag and drop that in, copy into the folder, and I tell it to add to all frameworks. Sorry, all targets. Okay, so if we have a look at the targets here, we'll see that the plugin itself does not yet have it, so I'll add that in right now. And the framework also does not have it, so Xcode just lied to me. Okay, so I've just dropped the image into the resources package, so now both the plugin and the framework have access to this icon. The next thing that I do, having added that image to both targets, is open up the integration view, integration code. So now I haven't shown you this before, so I'll do it quickly now. This is used for essentially telling Interface Builder more information about your object. So this is stuff like the IB populate key paths, for example, provides information to Interface Builder about what the properties Interface Builder should be watching are. So things that are visible, things that are going to change the way that your view looks in Interface Builder, IB needs to know about it because it needs to be able to hook into changes that are made to it. And it does this through key value observation. So in this method here, if you return, add an array of strings representing the properties, the visible properties, to the IB attribute key paths element in the Interface Builder object, then it will take care of it for you. You can also, if you're familiar with Interface Builder's inspector here, you'll notice that we have a couple of panes in the inspector. We have both the library object template, we also have the inspector for its superclass. So the way that Interface Builder knows about that is that we have this method called IB popular attribute inspector classes, which is not too long at all. And all that does is add the class object to a array of known classes inside Interface Builder. So what we're going to do now, we're going to add a method that returns an image that's being used within Interface Builder to represent our object. So I'm just going to jump up into my code bin. Where is it? Appears I appeared to have not included it in that one there, so I grab it from there. Okay, so this code here is very, very simple. It pulls out the path for the image from the bundle and returns, it allocates and inits and returns an image based on that path. Okay, so when I run it, create a new window, and I'm going to drag and drop it into the document itself. And there we are. So there's my icon. Sorry? The red square. It's actually not an icon. It's actually, this is Interface Builder calling the draw method from my object and displaying in there. It's not an icon. So what's interesting is that from within the library object template, we can include any image we like. And shortly, when I make a non-view object, I'm going to be including a small hack to make it look pretty, even though it has no visible representation to the user. Okay. So, we have icons now, which is fantastic. Okay, so as I mentioned before, if you tell Interface Builder to observe the visual properties of your object, it will then observe them through key value observation and repaint as necessary. So these include the text of a label, the color, anything visible. Now, let's take a look at the inspector. So far, we haven't done anything with the inspector. So far, we've just been saying, okay, this object retains its defaults. The inspector ties into your object through Cocoa bindings. So all of Cocoa is really becoming integrated at this point. In order for your object to be binding compliant, it needs to be key value coding compliant. So if you're using the Cocoa standards for naming your variables and properties within your objects, then you're already doing this. To hook your inspector up to your object, you need to bind to properties of the inspected object controller's selection property. Inspected object controller is a special object within Interface Builder that is actually an array controller that represents the objects in your view or in your window that are currently selected. And the selection property of that is simply the single object selected at the time. So let's make an inspector that ties into our object, and is there a hum in here? It doesn't matter. So that an inspector that ties into the object and allows you to modify it at design time. Okay, so I'm going to go and open up for the first time the inspector. All right, so this is what appears in the inspector pane. Notice it doesn't include the header at the top, that's it for us, but it does contain a bunch of guidelines for us. So we should keep these guidelines because they're very useful. Now, if you recall, the four editable properties of our object that weren't outlets were the two colors, the line width, and the roundness. So we're going to add a pair of color wells, and also a couple of number steppers. So, fill, stroke, get rid of these. Okay. So I'm just creating the objects that will be used later on for modifying it. Okay. And I don't need this label here, but I will say this is line width and this is roundedness. Or actually say rounding, that fits better. Get rid of that. And finally, I'm going to make the height quite a bit smaller because otherwise we're going to be wasting space. So I'll make that 150. That'll do. Okay, now that we've set up the interface, let's actually test that. Okay, so when I drag and drop my object into here. All right, so now we have our inspector, but it isn't actually hooking up to anything. This doesn't control what the view looks like. So let's fix that. Okay, the way that we hook up our inspector to the object that we're working with is through the bindings panel. Okay, so I'm now looking at the bindings of the fill color well. We simply bind the value of this to the value to the appropriate property in our object. So we, to get access to that object, we bind to the file's owner. File's owner, and it's IB. What was my thing? Inspected Objects Controller. Okay, so this represents the object that we're working with, and I want to bind it to the fill color. Okay, that's bound. Let's do the same thing for the stroke. So inspected objects. Okay, and we'll do the same thing here for these. So I'm going to bind this to the line width property. I'm actually just going to copy that because I'm going to use it again. Okay, and this one as well. So it's a little bit of grunt work, but nothing too bad. Roundedness, okay. All right, that's it. So when we run this, drag and drop, and there we are. And now we can change the color. We can change the line width. Change the color of the line first so we can see what we're doing. Make that a little bigger. Make the rounding nice and huge. Okay, so we now have a configurable, inspectable, reusable object that we can deploy to anywhere. So it's pretty cool, I think. Okay. So as I mentioned before, it looks a lot better if you set the names, paths, and descriptions of your objects. But in some cases, you don't want to be working with NSView subclasses. You want to be working with subclasses of NSObject. So things that don't necessarily have any real view to the end user, but are important to have in your program itself. So the way that we deal with that is we modify what the drag and represented views are with your object. So let's say that we aren't happy with the way that this works. We're dragging this out, but we have this ugly red box. Let's instead drag out that icon that we were working with before. So the way that we can do that is we can set the dragged view setting for our library. So if we take a look at the outlets, we can see that there's a bunch of outlets, including dragged view and represented object. Dragged view is the view that is dragged out from the library into anywhere else. So while you're dragging it out, it becomes this object. The represented object stands for the thing that is actually placed. So it's possible to have this simply stand in for something else. So we could have this stand in for something for an entirely different thing. It could be a window, or it could be an object. It doesn't really matter. Okay, so let's change it so that we're dragging out an object, an icon, that green Y icon, but we're actually dropping in the view. Okay, so I'm going to create a image view control that is going to be the dragged view. Okay, so drag in an image well. Set the image. Set the border to none, because I don't want that. Finally, I set the dragged view outlet to the image. Save that, go back to Xcode and run. And now we have the dragged view. If you haven't set a represented object, becomes the represented object. So the way that we can correct this issue is we go back into the inspector and say that the represented object is in fact this. Let's try that again. Okay, so when I drag that in now, so there's these two phases. I drag it out, it becomes the dragged view. I drag it into an area, and it becomes the represented object. So this is a way to create an intermediary step. In case you aren't sure how it's going to display unless it's in a window, it's often useful simply to have an image that provides some sort of feedback to the user on how it might look. Okay. Now, I've mentioned a couple times already, non-view objects are just as easy to do in Interface Builder as view objects. So a non-view object could, for example, be a controller or some other NS object subclass that provides some useful ability to your application, but doesn't necessarily have a visual representation. So the way that we get around this problem of having something to display is we use a represented view. We show an icon in the library that is some abstract picture. We say that it's a represented class template, so we can't drag it into a window because that makes no sense. And we simply say to the library template that the represented object is in fact this other non-view object. So the way that we set the represented object is simply put this NS object subclass inside the nib as a top level object, which I'll show you in a second. Okay, so I'm going to add a new object to my library. I mean, this is going to be a widget that simply runs an alert sheet when it receives a message. Okay, it's going to have no visual representation. It's simply going to receive messages from other controls or other things in the document. Okay, so the first thing we do is we go to our framework and add the object itself. Okay, so a plain Objective-C class, and I'm going to call it SL widget. Okay. Now I'm going to copy in the code from elsewhere because just to save you some time. Okay, so as before, you need to implement NS coding, so you need to return, you need to implement init with coder, and you need to implement encode with coder. Even though we have no settable attributes, these methods need to be there. Otherwise, Interface Builder will crash because it's looking for methods that aren't there. Also implement this method here that creates and displays an NS alert sheet. Okay. So grab these, go back to Xcode. Okay, and that is it. Apart from one thing, I need to declare the method in the header. Okay, so now we have this object in our framework. Let's start telling Interface Builder about it. The first thing we do is we add a class description file so that IB knows about it. So I go class descriptions, add new file, and we go to the Interface Builder Kit section of the new templates, and we say it's a new builder class template. And this is the SL widget class description. Okay, now the first thing we need to change is the fact that it is not an NS view, it is in fact an NS object subclass, and it has one action, and that is do something with a colon. Okay, so now Interface Builder knows about the some information about it. The next step is we will create our integration category on it. So and this would be SL widget integration. Okay, make sure that we're adding the category to SL widget. Okay. We also, at this point here, want to tell Interface Builder about the inspector for it. Now, this is a class that doesn't yet exist, but I'm going to add it in a moment. Okay. Actually, no, let's just not have a inspector. This will just be a plain object that has no configurable object settings. It just receives methods. Receives messages, rather. Okay. The next step is we go to our library and we start configuring how it's going to look. So I'm actually going to change this away so that we're not going to get confused later on. So the drag view is the represented object for our original view. We're going to add a new Interface Builder template object. There we have that library template. Drag that in. Okay, now we add our image, which is just going to represent the non-view object inside here. Okay, that'll do. Doesn't need to be too precise. Provide some information about it. So this will be the SL widget. Path dev world to okay. Now important to remember, we make sure that it is a represented class template so that ID won't allow us to drag it into a view. Now that we have the fake object, so the thing that it's going to look like but not how it's going to behave, we now need to add the object itself, the thing that will be dragged into the document. So we subclass NSObject within IB, drag it out to the nib, and make it an SL widget. Okay, the next step is we set the represented object outlet. So when we drag out the object from the library, then we are in fact dragging out this widget. We also set the drag view to that. Okay. And now, when I run this, okay, we've got our widget. Whoa, and we just had a crash. Okay. One second. Huh, okay. Okay, well, it certainly seems that the widget was badly coded in that instance, but I am going to switch over to my backup because they're very handy to have. Okay. Oops, open, quit. Okay. So. When I run this, and when Xcode recompiles everything, okay. So we can't drag the object into a view. It won't let us because it's a represented class template. But we can drag it out here. And it knows about the received action. It knows that it has a do something method. So what we can do is, I'll actually just add another view here and add a button and another button. Okay, and now we just drag and drop to hook it all up. Okay, let's run it. Okay, so this still works. This is hooked up to our view and it does something visual and interesting. We also have the do something method that calls some code that displays an alert. So that's an example of how you can use a non-view object in your Interface Builder plugin and add things to your library that do fantastic stuff. An example is the aquatic Mac shareware protection system that provides a interface builder library that you just drag and drop the protection object into your nib and it takes care of everything for you. Okay. You can also set preferences inside your plugin. So for example, you can actually get information on plugin level preferences within interface Builder itself. By default, they will display simply a list of found controls and found classes inside the plugin, but you can provide more custom information. The way you do that is you create a nib that contains a view, you override the preferences view method in your IB plugin object, and then you simply return that view. So, quickly showing you that because we're kind of running out of time. If I show you the DevRel Kit plugin here, I have a method here called preferences view that simply loads a nib named DevRel Kit preferences with the owner set to self. I've got an outlet in the DevRel Kit object itself that is set to a view. So simply by loading this nib, I am setting the prefs view property and then returning it. The upshot of all that is that when I go to the preferences pane of Interface Builder and go to, am I at the right one? Doesn't appear to be. Okay. If I quit this, run it again. Yes, I was not in the right copy of Interface Builder. That is one of the pitfalls. Okay, DevRel Kit. So this is a simple view that I've added and Interface Builder now knows about. And we can get access to the settings of this by simple bindings. So, Interface Builder plugins are fantastic pieces of code. They're fantastic for a number of reasons. They're an easy way to package classes that you've written. They're an easy way to test out frameworks that you've written. So you want to create a testing harness for your framework without having to write in your application that does it. You can simply test it out in IB. And it's generally very good. I encourage you to do everything you can with them because they're wonderful pieces of code. So that's the end of my talk. Just want to remind you, Lightning Talks are at 12:50 today, so if you have an idea and 3 minutes to talk about something, go and sign up at the board by the registration desk. And does anybody have any questions? Thank you.